So when we think about division, oftentimes in division in the church, it used to be like, well, the Lutherans or the Catholics or the Presbyterians. People don't care that much about that anymore. Now we're more interested in like Democrats, Republicans, liberal, conservative. Most of our deep-held divisions are political. But this morning we're confronted with another kind that we don't often think about, but we need to think about, which is divisions within ourselves. When our lives, our personhood, our personality, who we are, becomes divided into pieces. Now, this is something different than, say, a kind of mental illness, that we might say it's connected. This is where the human being is like a mirror that's been dropped. And so you can see pieces of a reflection, and in this case, the reflection of God. But oftentimes, there are other competing images that are showing up and showing their face. And one of the things God wants to deal with is God wants to give us wholeness, and God wants to give us a kind of completeness. And so God wants to encounter the divisions, not even outside of ourselves, but within ourselves. And this has been an important part of the spiritual tradition that we have neglected in many cases. But today, with the story of Mary and Martha, we get to talk about it. Now, oftentimes when the story comes up, people go, oh, well, I'm a doer, and then I feel guilty about being a doer because Martha's being critiqued by God. You know, like, that's not what this isn't. We actually need the doers. In fact, all of the doers, we want you to do more. And those of you who aren't doing, you need to do something. The issue isn't the active life versus the life of contemplation, even though all of these are important conversations. The problem is Martha has done the inviting, which is true. Martha has done the preparation, which is true. She's done the cooking and the cleaning. She's done everything by herself. All of that is true. But the danger for Martha is, because of this dividedness in herself, she almost misses the opportunity to actually meet Jesus at her house. It's like Jesus said yes to the invitation. Jesus is going to stay for lunch. Jesus is going to visit. But she's so anxious, and really that word for when Jesus says you are anxious and worried is the Greek word for you are divided in yourself. So that's where that comes from. You are so divided that you're almost going to miss what's right in front of you, which is God. And God's intention is to take the broken pieces of ourselves, to receive them, and to make them whole. But we don't get there quite yet, because Martha, like I think most people would complain and say, look, you agreed to have Jesus over, and I'm not going to do all the work, Mary, you know, and all that. And so she says to Jesus, she offers a prayer. She says, Lord, and he says, yes. She says, tell my sister to help. Tell my sister to get up and do something, you know. And Jesus says, no. Jesus doesn't answer the prayer she offers, not because it's a bad prayer, because it's not going to be Mary who takes care of Martha, it's going to be Jesus who takes care of Martha. Martha's prayer is indicative of a prayer that we often offer, which is, we're trying to manage our own stuff, and we want someone else to come in and manage our stuff with us. It's the difference between a kind of healing and just a managing. Healing means it's been dealt with and it's part of your life, but it's not exercising power over you. And managing things in a therapeutic way just says, look, this is what it's going to be. Just see if you can learn strategies to manage what you're dealing with. And so Martha wants Mary to come in and help manage some of the division and anxiety and worry that she feels in herself. And Jesus doesn't send Mary into that work. And it's a reminder that sometimes our prayer, it's coming out of a right place. I want peace. I want wholeness. But I'm not going to get it by just bringing other people into my mess, bringing other people into the storm. There needs to be a different solution. And that solution is that Mary is not going to be the one to answer Martha's prayer. It's going to be Jesus. Jesus is going to receive the divided parts of herself, and he's going to make her whole. And he's going to receive all of that, and that's part of the gift. One of the hard things for Martha to hear, and the hard thing for us to hear, is when Jesus says, there is only one thing that is necessary. And what he's implicitly saying to Martha is, none of what you're worried about is necessary. It's not needed. So many of the things that we, if we invest our energy in it, we assume that it's valuable. Because why would I invest my energy in something if it's not valuable? But it's not true. We invest our energy in lots of things that aren't valuable. And then when someone tells us, you know, you're really wasting your energy on that, they say, how dare you say that? You know, don't judge me. I know what's best for me and all that. We become very defensive because now we're being challenged with the possibility that all of the voices of division within ourselves are actually lying to us, are not telling us the truth about who we are and who we are supposed to be. And so the one thing that is necessary is that Jesus takes those broken pieces and makes them whole. Now, this isn't an innovation. This is what God has done since the beginning. So we can go all the way back to that story from Genesis you had. And that story from Genesis is a very important story for Christians because it's one of the first times explicitly that we see, now this is a Christian reading, we see the Holy Trinity present with Abraham, a type, a figure of the Holy Trinity, because you get three persons who are distinct. They speak with one voice. You know, they kind of have, they're all thinking the same thing. They're united in their will, and they're encountering Abraham as a special person. Part of the story that's not in there is they even say, should we bring Abraham into our council? We're down here for a reason. Should we bring Abraham into our council? And they say, yes, we should. It's the idea that God wants us to be whole so that we can wholly participate in God. Now, one of the things, if you remember, that Abraham and Sarah had prayed for a long time was a baby, and they hadn't gotten a baby. And anyone who's ever wanted a baby and couldn't get pregnant knows exactly how Sarah has felt. And at a certain point, the prayer they offered, they gave up on, because they just knew biologically this is not going to be possible. This womb that has not had life will not have life. That's just going to be part of her story. And then the last thing one of the visitors says, and it's very reminiscent of the Holy Spirit who will come over Mary, so we can imagine that it's the same voice speaking, says, when I come back next year, she's going to have a baby. Now, the verse that's left out right after this is it says, and Sarah heard, and she laughed. And her laughter isn't a happy laughter. Her laughter is a mocking laughter. Yeah, right. Yeah, okay, sure. Yeah. Like when Jesus says to Martha, you're worried about the wrong things and none of this is necessary. You can hear her go, okay, Jesus, okay. You know, like, right. Sarah has that same sort of mocking resentment, which is, it's too late. God, it's too late for you to answer my prayer. I've decided that it's not going to be possible. My body's too old. I mean, imagine if I went and visited the oldest member that we could have in our parish, and I said, next year, in 2020, you're going to have a baby. And they go, oh, they go, I didn't ask for that. I didn't ask for that prayer. But when Sarah has the child, she's almost 100 years old in the text. And it's the idea that what we thought was an end is actually a beginning. She thought her life was over. She thought her period of fertility is over. She thought that everything was over as it normally should be. But God comes and says, no, your end is actually a new beginning. And this is the gift that God offers. God can bring life into places that have never had life before. And God can bring life into places for you where there's never been life before, where things have only ever been divided, where there have only ever been shadows, where there's only ever been doubts. Those are the places that God wants to bring life. Because otherwise, God's doing what Martha wanted Mary to do, which is just manage the stuff that I'm already managing on my own. And that's not what God's about. God is not here to just provide an extra hand to help hold everything together. God is here to bring new life that we have not had or tasted, but that God wants us to have so that we can be whole. That is the good news of Christianity. New life in a place of death. Now, one of the things that Martha then is invited into, and we don't know what she did, is whether she said, you know what, you're right. I don't want to miss this opportunity to be with God. I don't want to miss this opportunity to connect with Christ. You're right. I'm going to sit here too and listen and commune and be with you. And as I was thinking about the text for this week and this sermon, I thought this is a great word for us in our church. Let's take a time to just be with God, to take a breath, and to take a moment to really consider what it is God is offering and calling us to. Now, this isn't a moment, I'm not going to go, now let us take a moment of silence, and now we're back. I'm talking about between now and Labor Day that we're going to take a little pause as a church. So we're not going to have our normal Bible studies, we're not going to have the adult forum, we're not going to have, and some of this just worked out with the calendar, but some of this, it's like, no, we need to stop everything, and we really need to think what it is God's calling us to as we look toward the fall. So it's not like we have a crisis. It's not like, well, we better figure out what we're going to do. This is taking a deep breath and saying, God, what broken pieces of our community do we need to give you? What wholeness do we need to receive from you? And I want to give you three words to think about. So last week, several people, and some of them are here today, we had lunch together because they had been part of another church in Costa Mesa that for 50 years had been strong and together and then ended up closing. And after time passed, and then part of them are part of our church, they gave LCR a gift, a financial gift. And so we met last week and discussed, what should we do with this gift? What would be a good way for us to honor the legacy of this congregation? And so that's the first word I want you to think about is legacy. Like, what is it that we've received from other people? What is it that we want to plant for the people who come after us? And so what we're going to do, and this is just the beginning, and you're going to be invited into this work, but what we're going to do is we're going to take some of that money and come up with a plan to refresh this space in which we worship. So, you know, finding a place for our praise team, our music, refreshing the space where we worship God in God's house. But to do that, we really need to ask ourselves, well, what are we doing when we worship? What is worship? What am I bringing to worship? What is God calling me to? So you'll notice in August, we're having three events, focus groups led by Gary Miller, that are only around the question of worship. And so the first one is going to be sort of our test group to make sure that the instruments are working properly. And so we're going to put that group together separately. But there are going to be two dates in August where you can come and be part of Gary's focus group. Offer your voice in terms of that question of worship and what we think and what we feel God is calling us to. So that's the second word, is worship. The first word is legacy, what we've been given, what we want to leave for the people who come after us. The second word is worship, how it is that my voice, my praise, my person, by myself and together, praises God in this place and outside of this place. And then the third word we're going to talk about is welcome. And by welcome, what I mean is we want to spend between now and Labor Day really refining the way that we welcome people to our church. Like, this is a great church. Like, there's nothing wrong with it. Again, we're not like broken, like, well, we've got some real problems here. But we need to be much more intentional about how we connect with people who aren't connected. How is it that we connect with people and find out who they are, what their gifts are, how they want to be involved, once they come to the church and what they can get connected to in the church? And so we have a group of people who will be working on this system of welcome. But part of it is to think for yourself, what is my role in that work? The work of welcome and the work of connecting, making connections. And part of what we'll see is God opening up then the family of our community so that new people can find a way to be integrated and not kind of just like kept here going, well, I don't know what to do next, but I like it here, but I don't know where to go next. So the website's going to be part of that work. A welcome team will be part of that work. But part of it too is your task of connecting people and being connected to people in the church. So those are the three words that we'll be thinking about during this little pause: legacy, worship, and welcome. And I want you to think about how it is that, like Mary and like Martha, we sit at the feet of Jesus and we offer up everything we have and everything we are, and God takes those things and makes us whole. And that gift of wholeness is so big, it overflows out of us into the lives of other people so they can see that God is good, the bringer of life in unexpected places. Amen. You're invited to stand as we make our confession of faith.